I'm happy to talk to you today, and I'm more than happy to show you this slide. This is like the French mortality registry in HIV patients, and what you see here, the red bar, liver disease. I'm showing you this to tell you liver disease plays an important role in morbidity and mortality in HIV patients. We used to show slides where these bars are rising and rising. Now they're going down a bit, and it's like non-AIDS cancer and these things coming up a bit more, but still liver disease is an important issue in HIV, and if you usually lots of brilliant ideas come from France. I'm going to show you this later as well. They're really inventive, but you need structured people to validate this. And the Swiss cohort, because the Swiss, they speak French, they speak German, they're a bit in between. The Swiss can confirm actually what the French had discovered, and this makes it important. Liver disease is a big issue, not the main cause of death in HIV patients, but I mean, this is one reason why we're meeting here, because liver disease is important. And more importantly, the Swiss cohort is comparing the HIV-related mortality to the general population. What you see is actually HIV patients die from similar diseases as the general population. Coming back to liver disease, this is even older, from 2006, but still it's true. It says that in the DAD study, which is a large cohort with more than 75,000 patient years, and we could see that 14% of the patients were dying from liver-related deaths, even in this study, which is quite a similar number than the one I was showing you before. And I'm showing you this to point out, one, that HCV is the main cause of liver-related death. This is clear. I mean, this we have, we all know, and hepatitis B may be the second, but there are still other causes of liver-related deaths, and we have to deal with it, and we have to take care, and maybe it's NAFLD, maybe it's other diseases. And also, one thing that I would like to point out, we don't know why some patients with HIV, HCV infection progress so fast. Sometimes we have time from infection to liver transplantation in 10 years. And there are clearly some underlying factors why in some patients hepatitis C is so severe and in others it's less. And we have to find out what this might be. I'm going to talk about some of the other things that can cause liver disease in HIV. And you see it here, it's related to alcohol and drugs. And other drugs and maybe infections. It's not all about Hep C. We have other problems, and I'm going to talk about these five issues. We'll have a short look on hepatitis E, although my talk is called non-viral hepatitis, but we need to cover it just a little bit. All of you have seen HIV patients with elevated liver enzyme. I think this is clear, and also the Swiss again. The Swiss cohort says 16%. Non-HCV, non-HPV, so non-viral hepatitis patients have elevated ALT levels, and it might be related to a high BMI, to alcohol intake, of course, to HIV viral load, and to cetavidin and zidovudine intake. So let's talk about alcohol first, because we always say alcohol is an issue, and then we don't go further into detail, and I think we have to, because alcohol is a big problem, and it affects many patients. And again, from the French Mortavik study, when they looked at patients who died from end-stage liver disease, you can see that the amount of patients who had an important alcohol consumption is fairly elevated. So, of course, this is not the main cause was alcohol consumption, but these were maybe patients who had a liver disease and were additionally drinking, and this was making the liver disease getting severe, and this is why it's important we have to deal with it, and we have to talk to our patients about it. And then there's many studies. Most of them are not really representative because the collectives are very different, and it's a different thing if you look in a mainly drug user collective or in a mainly MSM or in an immigrant community. So, but what has been pointed out in several studies is that heavy drinking is more common in HIV patients. We may discuss if this is true for every group, but it might be that in 13% is one number that's been given by a study, alcohol is responsible for elevated liver enzyme tests, and that heavy alcohol consumption has an impact on the immune system, so CD4 counts are lower even in not treated HIV patients, which is quite obvious. Heavy alcohol consumption may be related to adherence and therefore to viral HIV suppression. These are mechanisms. This is actually a review paper that sums up the effects of alcohol intake in this population. And all these things you're seeing here, we don't have to go into these details, but these are common mechanisms that have been described in actually hepatotoxicity. And when you look at these different factors, oxidative stress or lipid peroxidation, steatosis, mitochondrial toxicity, what you see that is HIV is may impact many of these different mechanisms. And viral hepatitis may also impact many of these mechanisms, of course, because it's a liver-damaging disease. And anti-HIV treatment may also affect these mechanisms. And then when people also drink, it means that probably you have an accumulation of different factors that impact the liver. And this is why it's important to talk to our patient, to ask them, are you drinking? How much are you drinking? And actually, it's also important to quantify the amount, because the WHO says when you drink more than 30 gram a day of pure alcohol as a man, more than 20 gram per day as a woman, you're in danger for actually the physical damage of alcohol use. And what is 30 gram? And let's say 2.5 of these small beers, 300 centiliters, yeah? Or it's 2.5 of these small glasses of wine, or like 2 to 3 shots. And this is all like the same amount of alcohol. It doesn't matter if somebody's drinking schnapps or vodka or becherovka or whatever people may choose, or beer. It's actually the amount of pure alcohol that is important. And when you say that each of these standard drink contains about 13 gram of pure alcohol, you can see how easily you can reach 30 gram per day. It's quite quickly done, I'm telling you. And one questionnaire, actually, it's the CAGE questionnaire, C-A-G-E, and it's been validated in HIV infection, and actually it's just a questionnaire that should help the physician, primary care physician, just to rule out if there might be an alcohol problem or not. And I mean, if you go through these four questions, only four questions, have you ever felt you should cut down your drinking? Somebody's laughing. Have people annoyed you by criticizing your drinking? Have you ever felt bad or guilty about your drinking? I mean, this is who hasn't? Have you ever had a drink first thing in the morning to steady your nerves? Okay, this is maybe something more severe. But what the people say who publish this question: if you have two or more positive answers, you're at a high risk of having an alcohol problem. This is a tool which you might use actually in your clinical practice to assess if there might be a problem with alcohol or in your patients. So let's go to antiretroviral drugs and toxicity. And actually, this is one of the slides which makes me actually realize that we're all getting older. Not only HIV patients are getting older, because Nazifa Qureshi, she published in 2003 in The Lancet actually that ARV treatment is prolonging survival, and that people benefit from HIV treatment even when they are HCV positive. And liver-related mortality was lower in the treated group compared to people with no ART, and which was one of the landmark trials that showed us ART is doing something good. But of course, we have to deal with toxicity, and we have to address this issue. And the problem with toxicity in HIV is that you always use combination treatment. This is why Maud cannot point out if it's the protease inhibitor or it's the cevidin, because usually people take both, and this makes it so difficult. And people take other drugs. People take, you name it. People take anti-TB drugs, people take lipid-lowering agents or whatever drugs. And so liver toxicity is quite difficult to work out. And then people take over-the-counter drugs. People go to the pharmacy and buy whatever they need, and they're just giving it. And if you think they tell you what they're taking, you're wrong. Because this is actually a Danish study. It has nothing to do with HIV. It's just, forget HIV. It's just old. It's Danish grandmas and grandpas. And they looked at 500 patients. And they were like, they found out that from nearly 500 patients, only 3% did not take any drug. And people took, on average, 4.2 different drugs and 2.5 over-the-counter drugs. And what is more striking is, like, a quarter of the prescribed drugs were used without the GP's knowledge, so the GPs did not know. About 25% of drugs people took, which they considered as their patients that they were seeing regularly and where they knew what was prescribed and wasn't, what not. And I mean, this is not an HIV collective, but you can actually use it as a parameter that people are using other drugs and over-the-counter drugs, and we don't know about it. And then there's also the under-the-counter drugs. You know, it's when you go on a classic, let's say, a rave party in Berlin. It's speed, it's ketamine, it's MDMA, it's what you want. People are buying stuff. People are getting it. I'm not saying that ecstasy is necessarily toxic to the liver. But what I'm saying is things are adding up, and people take ritonavir, so they have boosters, and they have, you know, we have drug-drug interactions and so on. And this is all coming together and actually causing a big problem, maybe also a problem in the liver. The other problem with hepatotoxicity is that it's not well defined, actually. The ACTG is using an ALT-based classification where they say, okay, 1.25 to 2.5 of the upper limit of normal is grade 1, and then 2.6 to 5 is grade 2, and then from 5 or to more than 10 times the upper limit of normal, then it gets severe, and then it's dangerous. Why? I mean, this is just a definition. A bit more sophisticated approach is using bilirubin as another marker, but still, this has not really well worked out. And why not using alkaline phosphatase, actually, to define between a more or less cytolytic or a cholestatic, actually, hepatotoxicity? And this has never led, actually, to a clear algorithm that is telling us this means now it's hepatotoxic and this is not. Actually, the only rule we're having is coming from Hyman Zimmerman. It's like from 1970, you know, and this guy said when you have AST or LAT more than three times the upper limit of normal and you get jaundice, then the risk of dying actually from this hepatotoxicity is more than 10%. So hepatotoxicity is not really well worked out, but there has been a review paper from Marina Nunez I think she's in the U.S. She's from Spain originally, but she works in the U.S. And this is actually a review paper that I can definitely recommend to you reading when you want to know about drug toxicity. And actually what she was saying is she classified drug toxicity in five main mechanisms. One is immune reconstitution in viral hepatitis co-infection. I think this is easy. When you have a patient who is hepatitis, it might be easy actually, a co-infection, and you put him on treatment and CD4 count is going up, he might reactivate or he might have immune reconstitution hepatitis. But then she says it's either hypersensitivity or it's mitochondrial toxicity or it's lipid or sugar metabolism or it's direct liver cell stress, whatever that means. It's one of the mechanisms that I was showing you before. And it's quite vague to have this. But still, hypersensitivity, we know that we have our bad guys. It's abacavir and you have the HLA-B5701 testing. Of course, mitochondrial toxicity, you have all the, especially the D-drugs, but all the nukes to blame. And in a hypersensitivity reaction, we were talking about it already because we had this case, it's especially nevirapine that is causing trouble, but all non-nukes could potentially cause allergy or a hypersensitivity reaction. And so it has been reported as well for darunavir, because Sanjay, you were talking about darunavir. There has been a reported case of rash and liver failure on darunavir treatment. And it has also been reported for maraviroc, which is not very much known, but maraviroc has also a black box warning from the FDA for hypersensitivity and liver toxicity. So on the direct liver cell stress, it's mainly didaidanosine, also the non-nukes, nevirapine and efavirenz, and ritonavir at full dose or tipranavir. I'm just showing that this slide is coming from the same publication. I only want to show you this because clearly you have a higher risk for liver enzyme elevations in patients who have a hepatitis co-infection. They are all more at risk to develop liver toxicity than those who don't. I put the actual data for rilpivirine down there, which has also higher ALT elevations in Hep C and Hep C patients. And here you can see the drugs where there's black box warnings from the FDA, and you can see that all nukes have them for liver toxicity. It's because of the mitochondrial damage. And then it's nevirapine, of course, and it's tipranavir, and it's maraviroc. Just another word on viramune and nevirapine, because I mean, you all know it can cause liver toxicity, it can cause hypersensitivity reaction, but this is true, and probably you all know that this is true for patients with high CD4 count, and this is also true for patients with detectable HIV viral load. So when your patient is suppressed And even when it when your patient has high CD4 count, but the HIV viral load is suppressed, this is not true anymore. So it's safe to switch a patient on the nevirapine, and it has led to European recommendations that saying women with a CD4 count of above 250 or men with a CD4 count of above 400 should not be put on nevirapine first line unless the patient has undetectable actually plasma HIV viral load, then it's safe to be used. And Marina Nunes in the same paper is suggesting an algorithm how to manage HIV drug toxicity, and what she's saying is basically when your patient has symptoms, meaning either symptoms of an allergy, of an hypersensitivity reaction, rash and fever and eosinophils and so on, or signs of lactic acidosis or jaundice, you should stop all the drugs and all the potential hepatotoxic drugs. When the patient is asymptomatic, of course you should rule out an underlying liver disease which may cause this, and if this is not the case and the patient has grade 3 ALT elevations, you should either change or you can continue but have to closely monitor. If the patient has grade 4, meaning upper higher than 10 times the upper limit of normal, then you should stop the ARVs and should, if possible, wait until ALT has improved before you trying a new treatment regimen. So I'm presenting you another John, just to wake you up a little bit. It's a 53-year-old man. He's MSM. He's HIV infected since 1997. He's been put on antiretroviral treatment because of low CD4 count, CDC stage A3. And he says he doesn't remember what he took and HIV drugs all his life, but he took a lot. In fact, it's AZT, 3TC, DDI, D4T, tenofovir, nevirapine, calitra, zacunavir, fosamprenavir, atazanavir, and of course ritonavir. Ever so, it was he had problems with taking these drugs, but still, apparently, he took them because he was still running on Truvada, Ryotats, which still worked. And he was presenting because he was not feeling fine. He had night sweats and he was losing weight and so on, so on, so on. He also has hepatitis co-infection and hepatitis C was genotype 1B. And he was never treated. He had a high viral load, but he didn't have any problems from Hep C so far. And has a history of acute hepatitis B. Anyway, he was on Truvada. And this is his lab work. AST was 1.7, the upper limit of normal. ALT was 1.8. Gamma GT also twice the upper limit of normal. No AP. He had some bilirubin elevated. And normal platelets, normal albumin, normal INR, so no signs of hepatocellular insufficiency. And he had a fibroscan of 4.9. So this is what we call a discordance. What do you think? What would you do? I mean, at least you would do an ultrasound, and the liver looked strange on ultrasound. And he also had endoscopy. He was just part of the German approach. I mean, what would you do? You have a fibro test that indicates, yeah, there is some fibrosis, but there's a problem with the bilirubin and the atazanavir, and he has a fibro scan that says the liver is normal. And now his liver looked a bit strange. And he has varices. So he's getting a liver biopsy, and then something like this comes out of the liver. What you see is in this liver biopsy, he has nodules, and these nodules are not separated by fibrosis, which is the big difference to liver cirrhosis, and the hepatocytes are either atrophic or they are thickened, swollen, and he also had dilated sinus, so there's some kind of blood flow problem in this liver, and this is what's called nodular regenerative hyperplasia, and because it's a horrible word for German, I'm going to call it NRH from now on. So he has this disease, which might explain his portal hypertension. And this disease is a disease that's been described especially by Spanish and French groups since 2007, which is known to be related in other diseases like rheumatological disorders and certain drugs, and which is meant to be a vascular disease, actually, which probably begins by an arteritis and a secondary obstruction of the portal veins, but the small branches of the portal veins, so you usually don't have a portal vein thrombosis, but you could measure actually elevated portal pressure, which would have been a good idea actually, but still the diagnosis is there. And actually Vincent Mallet from Paris was one of the first to describe this, and his patient, they showed up either with variceal hemorrhage or they had variceal hemorrhage in the even after follow-up, but some of them also presented with this as the first problem. Or they had isolated thrombocytopenia or cholestasis, and when they did actually endoscopy, all of them had large varices. So this was occult cases of portal hypertension, and as you can see here, 5 in 8 of his described patients also bled from these varices. So this was a significant problem for these patients, and again, a brilliant idea from France, validated by the Swiss. This is the Swiss cohort. They were collecting all these cases, and you can see here these are mainly, and they made it an asset control study on it, and these are mainly case reports, small number of patients, but still the problem seems to be there and seems to be a bit everywhere, and the more you talk about it, the more people find it, because often these patients are just classified as cirrhotics or whatever, we don't know why they have varices, and you can see that in most of these cases also NRH was found as the underlying cause. In this American paper, they called it hepatoportal sclerosis, but probably hepatoportal sclerosis is some kind of the, maybe another stage of the same disease. Anyway, this seems to be actually the problem, and this is what's coming out in all the analysis. There is a relation to didanosine use. I won't say it can only be caused by DDI, but there is a relation, and it turns out to be significant ever having taken didanosine in your lifetime, not at the time of the diagnosis. So actually this Spanish group found basically the same thing. Time on HIV drugs and time on DDI were significantly correlated with this disease. The reason why this has happened is not entirely understood. This is a slide from Vincent Soriano from Madrid, who just suggests that if you have unexplained low platelets or elevated transaminases or AP and GGT elevation or signs of portal hypertension, you should look for this disease, and probably it's DDI consumption that can cause the high pressure in the portal veins. Why is not entirely clear. Maybe it's related to coagulation, and Vincent Mallet is himself suggesting, and they could even prove this in some of their patients at least, that it's a problem of acquired protein S deficiency by antibodies that you develop against protein S. But these are hypotheses. We don't know actually where this disease is coming from, except from drug use, ARV drug use. Hepatitis E, we were talking about it quickly. Also, I don't want to go deeply into the detail. We have highly endemic areas, which are mainly in developing countries in Eastern Asia, Northern and Eastern Africa. But it's also in this part of the world where we are, it's endemic, not at the same extent, but actually this is also what the working group in Germany from Hanover, and actually what they find is the more they look, the more they find. So this disease is definitely more prevalent or more endemic than we thought, also in Western Europe and also in Eastern Europe. I just want to tell you quickly that it's, as I told you, it's highly endemic in developing countries, but also in our countries they have been locally acquired diseases, and it can be transmitted by animals, rodents, and wild boars, and even shellfish is suggested as a way of transmission. Usually it's like hepatitis A, self-limited disease, not very severe, but in elder patients and pregnant women and in patients with chronic liver disease, of course it can aggravate the underlying disease, and chronic hepatitis E has been actually described in transplant patients and also with a bit more question marks in HIV patients, but there have been cases, and this is also a case from Vincent Mallet from Paris. As you can see, I stole lots of his slides. but I admit it at least. And this is a patient who underwent a kidney transplant and who had and who developed ALT elevations, and they could not explain why this was the case. And retrospectively, they found that it's been a problem of hepatitis E PCR positivity. So this patient had a hepatitis E infection, transplant patient, and did not. This disease was definitely not self-limiting. And I'm showing you this actually because they were treating this disease with ribavirin, so it seems to work. There's also been other case reports where ribavirin was given and treated and cured patients with hepatitis E, so this might be a treatment option if you have a case like this. And it's usually an easily accessible drug, so this is why I'm telling you this. Thanks for listening.